Hello, I'm Infamous Fear. What's that? It's time for Infamous Queer!
Pride, 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 darling, darling, pride, pride 95!
You've probably heard that song a good many times, or at least the first 5 seconds of it. But now I want you to think about it. What is pride exactly? Almost every right that LGBT people have has been fought for. Over the years, LGBT people have been arrested, fired, interned, killed, subjected to various horrible medical treatments that were not only completely ineffective, but also caused irreparable damage, and subjected to hate crime. We've been told that we are abhorrent, perverse, that we need to change in order to be acceptable, or worse, that there's no redeeming us. Pride is a reminder that we can look at ourselves, at our differences, what makes us not normal, and say, you know what? I like this about myself. I am worthy of loving. I am worthy of being treated with respect, of being given legal rights, of being considered a human being in the eyes of the law. The world can be a dangerous place for LGBT people. All too frequently we're reminded of why pride is important. The parades that typify pride are a commemoration of the riots that queer people had, of the literal fight they engaged in order to be heard. And there is no riot more famous than the one that took place at the Stonewall Inn in New York in 1969. So what would happen if you took this crucial event in LGBT history and then took a giant shit directly on top of it? If you threw out all of these historical facts and changed the ethnic makeup, cultural background and gender identity of many of the people who were there and instead twisted it into a generic coming-of-age story for a person who didn't even exist? Well, then you'd end up with a movie that absolutely nobody wanted. This is Stonewall. Ah yes, Stonewall. This 2015 movie was a passion project brought to life by openly gay director of scientifically warped disaster movies, Roland Emmerich. Even before the movie's release, it attracted significant ire from the LGBT community, and just about everyone outside it with even the tiniest shred of social awareness. And of course, I immediately knew that I had to watch it. I've survived some of the worst queer movies in existence. How bad could it be? Let's begin. For a movie about an important historical event, the plot is astonishingly generic, so I'd like to get it over and done with as soon as possible. Here's Danny, our shiny middle American corn farm protagonist. After being kicked out by his homophobic family, he arrives in New York and is immediately accosted by some outlandish street kids who randomly cause mayhem and generally just run around being as gay as possible, just in case we didn't get it. The de facto head of the gang is a person called Ray, who immediately takes a liking to Danny, although Ray has a funny way of showing it.
Jesus, you don't know nothing, do you?
You know, Danny? You're turning out to be a real New York cocksucker. Learning how to lie before you even get dressed!
Ray introduces Danny to the magical place, the Stonewall Inn, where you can dance if you want to and leave your friends behind and all that. While there, Danny meets his Peter Serafinowicz-looking guy, Trevor, and is seduced by his... charms?
So, this particular shithole does not live like Danny's natural habitat.
Anyway, Danny dates Trevor for a bit, breaks up with him, hangs out with Ray some more, ends up in sex slavery or something.
Wait, what?
This is Danny. He's exactly what you gents were asking for.
Oh, Christ, we'll have to revisit this later.
So one night, there's a raid on the Stonewall Inn by police, and unlike normal, the bar owner isn't tipped off ahead of time, so everyone gets arrested. Ray and Danny are really mad. Danny, a completely invented person, then starts the Stonewall riot single-handedly, and everything gets smashed or something.
No, Trevor! It's the only way! Gay power! Come on! Gay power!
Everything's fixed. Danny solved homophobia, and now he can go back to Indiana a year later to be rejected by his closeted ex-boyfriend.
Danny. I'm married.
The end.
So I'm sure that you could see that that wasn't very good.
Your life is so great, Ray! Getting beat up all the time and blowing guys in doorways?
Yeah!
But rather than immediately reacting with anger, I think we need to scientifically study exactly why this movie is so putrid.
The aesthetics. I've never seen another Emmerich movie in my life, but I've heard he's a credible enough director when it comes to making movies that look like movies, with good lighting and colour profiles and big set pieces the audience can follow.
Stonewall, on the other hand, is an ugly, ugly film.
The colour grading is excessively harsh, bathing everything in an incredibly aggressive yellow, making it look like you're watching it on your computer and you forgot to turn off Airflux. The grading makes all of the actors look bad, whether they're young and attractive or whether they're not. It also makes everyone look as if they're the same indeterminate race.
It might seem odd that I'm bringing up race, but when discussing Stonewall, it's all too relevant.
The way the film is structured isn't particularly good either, and it's long. Oh God, it's at least 30 minutes longer than it needs to be. The few action sequences are filmed badly and unconvincingly, and the production design looks decidedly soundstagey. The music is okay, and the costume might be alright if we could actually see it. Stonewall frequently looks grotesque. The only way it could have been worse is if it were filmed on tape.
It's now surprisingly affordable to make a movie that at least looks acceptable, especially if it doesn't involve any CGI, special effects makeup, or large complicated set pieces. So one wonders how exactly Roland Emmerich managed to make this movie look so terrible. I mean, I know I look like shit right now, but I have no lighting technician, no director of photography, and no budget.
Tangerine looks significantly better, and that was filmed on a phone. The history.
For a movie based on a historical event, Stonewall is significantly made up. However, there is some degree of lip service paid to actual historical fact.
The Stonewall Inn and many other gay bars were indeed controlled by the Mafia, because they were technically illegal businesses. This is not to say that the Mafia loved gay people, more that they recognised the business opportunity.
You gotta sign in, okay? Don't use your real name. This shithole is run by the mob. You don't got a liquor license.
What do you mean this place is run by
the mob? Oh, listen, bitch. Don't you know that selling alcohol to a sexual deviant is illegal? That's why these greasy fucktards and bastards run almost all the gay bars in the village.
Non-criminal business owners didn't want to cater to a clientele who was liable to cause legal trouble. But the Mafia got around this by paying off the police. They would receive tip-offs before every raid and were able to warn their customers. I'm not sure if the Mafia were involved in pimping out some of their sex worker clientele, but I can't rule it out.
The anti-gay PSA that Danny's father shows the school is unfortunately also real.
Bobby and his friends hadn't noticed the man who had been in the restroom when they changed. Bobby and his friends hadn't noticed the man who had been in the restroom when they changed. Let's take the case of Jimmy Barnes.
But while some of the events and situations portrayed might be accurate, the film doesn't give much time to the actual people who were there.
There are historical figures in this movie, such as queer liberation activist and drag queen Marsha P. Johnson, and gay rights activist and victim of the Lavender Scare, Frank Kameny. But they're not introduced or presented accurately, or given much screen time. If you know the history behind the Stonewall riots and the gay liberation movement in America, you might recognise their very brief appearances. But many of the historical figures in this movie aren't properly introduced, nor is their significance explained. Emmerich patronises the viewer by awkwardly inserting some text at the end of the film, acknowledging the historical details in a manner that's far too little too late. Many of the people he mentions in the credits were barely given dialogue in the film itself. Who's this guy, for instance? We see him in a couple of scenes, where Danny relates to him in a manner that indicates that they already know each other, but we have no idea who he is, or why he's important, until he's briefly mentioned in the end credits.
It would have almost been less insulting if Emmerich had just made everything up, because this approach just makes you angry about how little history Emmerich bothered to explain. The short shrift given to real people is nothing short of offensive. Oh, and speaking of offensive...
The homophobia.
For a movie ostensibly about gay rights, Stonewall is weirdly homophobic.
Almost every gay character who isn't Danny is portrayed in a way that's rather negative. They're either obnoxious or downright villainous, with some of them looking exactly like they've stepped out of a chick tract.
It's almost as if the film was infiltrated by other interests who wanted to make the Stonewall Inn look like a hell house.
However, these unsubtle, scary gays aren't the only manifestation of homophobia we see in Stonewall. We're first introduced to Trevor when he beckons Danny over on the dance floor.
I have no idea what Roland Emmerich wants us to think about Trevor.
He's set up in a way that makes him look weirdly creepy and predatory, leading me to believe that he was yet another one of the grotesque gay people we were supposed to view as a threat. But then it turns out that Trevor is a member of the Mattachine Society, a real activist organisation that was established to campaign for the rights of gay people. At the time, the queer rights movement was changing from being a mostly behind-the-scenes intellectual pursuit, mostly involving educated, white, left-leaning men, into a more active and revolutionary campaign of civil disobedience and protest.
I'd argue that both approaches were important when it came to the development of the current LGBT rights movement. The Mattachine Society might have been a very safe organisation that wasn't always effective, but it can't be entirely dismissed as a force for change.
But in Stonewall, it's depicted in a way that makes everyone at the meeting look like creepy corporate drones who hate freedom. Here's Frank Kameny, a government worker who was fired for being gay and the first openly gay man to run for Congress. They made him look like a fucking skull.
Trevor also doesn't do anything particularly bad, but he's somehow still portrayed as a villain.
In one scene he offers Danny, who's literally homeless, a place to stay. And Danny reacts as if Trevor asked him to wear a dog suit and give him fellatio, despite the fact that Trevor's offer seems like a perfectly reasonable suggestion to me.
Why don't you just stay here with me? You know, for a little while.
Are you still drunk? Or are you just talking shit?
No. You could get a job, start paying me some rent so it doesn't feel weird.
There are a few ways you could have portrayed this character. Either he's a handsome beefcake who later turns out to be a dickhead, or he appears creepy at first glance and then turns out to be a genuinely nice guy. Somehow both of these ideas got meshed together. Jonathan Rhys-Meyers does not look appealing in this movie.
He's usually much better looking, but somehow the ugliness of Stonewall's alleged aesthetic made him look exactly like British comedian Peter Serafinowicz. Serafinowicz is a very funny and clever comedian and great music video director, but he's not the sort of man you cast as anyone's love interest ever, because, well, look at him.
He looks like he teaches maths. In a bunker.
That said, he somehow still has more romantic chemistry with Will Arnett in this comedy sketch than we can find in the whole of Stonewall.
All right, bye.
Take it easy.
Yeah, you too.
Yeah, nice yeah. Running into you.
Yeah.
A damning indictment if I ever made one. Trevor is supposed to be appealing and seductive, and yet he's filmed in a way that makes him look as if he's going to take advantage of Danny and do something terrible to him. But instead, he's pretty reasonable. But later he turns out to be a wanker who cheats on Danny and...
What the hell even is this character? We've either had our expectations subverted about 3 times, or we haven't had them subverted at all. Stonewall!
On the other side of queer representation, we have Ray, an invented character who draws significant inspiration from Sylvia Rivera, a queer trans woman and activist who had significant involvement in the riots. She's one of the people credited as throwing the first brick, a privilege that's handed off to Danny in the movie because of course it is. Later, she expressed disappointment at the queer community's refusal to acknowledge the contributions by trans and gender non-conforming people and people of colour to the gay rights movement in favour of white, masculine gay men.
Case in point, this movie.
Danny has 3 sort of love interests. There's Joe, the quarterback he was secretly dating back in Corntown, Indiana, Trevor, the Peter Serafinowicz-looking fucker with a procul harem obsession, and Ray, who's obviously interested in Danny from the start. However, Ray's attraction to Danny is dismissed in a way that's very uncomfortable.
Ray, come on. Don't you understand?
No.
I mean, what am I supposed to understand? That I can't love you.
Notice that he doesn't say that he doesn't love her. He says that he can't love her.
You'll always be my sister.
Dude, can't you just say that you don't feel that way about her instead of implying that she's somehow worth less as a human being because she's too effeminate or too brown or something?
Do you know what I mean? I mean, different isn't even the word. Danny, you don't think I know that?
Yes, according to Stonewall, there's only one acceptable way of being gay.
Be white. Be an activist, but not too much, and only in the right way. Don't be weird-looking. Don't be a woman because I guess they don't exist or something. And don't, for God's sake, in any way, shape or form, be too gay, or you'll be portrayed so negatively that you might as well be an anti-gay propaganda.
If you can live up to those arbitrary standards, you're set!
The sex work.
Stonewall acknowledges the reality for many young queer people at the time, that they were homeless and supported themselves with sex work.
Ray started tricking in Times Square when he was 12.
However, the depiction of sex work in this film is really odd and uncomfortable. Not uncomfortable in the way that you'd expect, in the way that it's portrayed in other films, where characters feel unsafe or vulnerable or without options, but uncomfortable in a whole new way.
On this show, I've covered a lot of stories about sex workers, and I'm confident in saying that this is the worst one. It completely lacks any sense of subtlety or humanity.
Emmerich isn't content to show the actual potential risks of sex work, that it can re-traumatise survivors of sexual abuse, that it can be physically dangerous in many ways, and that sex work is often illegal, thus causing the workers to be harassed and offered no legal protection.
Instead, he has to invent new ones.
Off note is a scene where Danny is randomly kidnapped off the street by evil bar proprietor mobster Ron Perlman, and then forced into sex slavery for one hot minute.
Why? There is no reason for this scene, and it makes no narrative sense!
It would be incredibly easy to show that evil Ron Perlman had some kind of hold over Danny. Maybe Danny borrowed money off evil Ron Perlman when he was new to the neighbourhood, and now evil Ron is forcing him to pay his debts. Maybe evil Ron Perlman threatens Danny with violence or with arrest.
Either scene would take 5 minutes at most, but apparently Emmerich forgot that it was probably important to include some kind of setup for the random sex slavery sequence in his movie.
Naturally, the people he's supposed to service are every conservative's worst nightmare manifested into human form, with one being a weirdo in a smoking jacket, and the other being a purposefully grotesque crossdresser.
And I am a good friend, Danny. I am a very good friend to nice young boy.
However, Danny is rescued by Ray before anything happens, so the whole scene was completely without consequence, except to give Ray something to do and, I don't know, make some weird homophobic statement?
Yes, Stonewall is a movie with random sex slavery in it. Sex slavery that has no impact on the plot, wasn't established, and is then never mentioned again. What the ever-living fuck?
The finer points of Danny.
Much of the furore surrounding Stonewall involves Emmerich's decision to make the lead character a white, masculine, cis man he completely invented, sidelining the trans people of colour who actually existed.
It's clear why Danny is in this movie. He's a contrived and obvious attempt to make the film appeal to a mass audience. He's generic and approachable, the sort of gay man who can be described as not like those other gay people who have to make such a big deal out of it. We already know about his generic backstory, which coincidentally is exactly the same as Kevin's from Dante's Cove.
I don't even think it's true. And I don't know why you do.
There are signs, and if you don't want to see them, that's fine, but I do.
Oh, do I need to spell it out for you?
Jack!
Why don't you just call me gay to my face and get it over with?
Well, are you? Because I'm not living in the same house with a faggot.
I'm just gonna make this easy on you, okay? I'm out of here.
However, even this relatively cliched tale of a small-town boy kicked out of his home by his ragingly homophobic dad manages to be poorly written and confusing. The backstory starts with Danny and his classmates being shown the notorious anti-gay PSA, Boys Beware. We later learn that they're all being shown this film because Danny's father, the football coach, who I'll just call Colonel Fitz, already suspects that Danny is gay, for some reason. Now, this is the late 60s. When awareness of homosexuality was not particularly good, gay people were frequently only understood in terms of the most cliched stereotypes, that of effeminate mummies boys and rampaging sex offenders. So why the hell would Colonel Fitz suspect that his masculine, sport-playing son is gay? Again, there's an easy fix. Either Colonel Fitz doesn't know Danny's gay until he's found actually doing something gay, which he is, so the story would still play out in exactly the same way, or there's at least some established reason for Colonel Fitz to be suspicious.
Danny should be effeminate. He should be a bookish kid, or the sort of boy who's been called a sissy his entire life.
Maybe give Danny a classically boisterous brother who Colonel Fitz favours, while rejecting his more flamboyant son.
Yes, it would be a stereotype, but it would at least provide a reason for why Colonel Fitz suspects his son is gay. And fucking hell, it's Stonewall! It's already a cliché. You might as well make it an accurate one. But no, we couldn't have an effeminate male lead, because this is a serious movie, and effeminate male leads are only for comedies. Making Danny flamboyant would make him too gay, and therefore not accessible.
Meanwhile, Danny's sister is aggressively unhomophobic, which doesn't make that much sense either.
Mr. Truman Capote, who wrote In Cold Blood, is also a homosexual. Maybe that's why I wasn't allowed to see that movie either.
Phoebe, we're having dinner. Thank you.
One would expect that she'd be at least a little hesitant about homosexuality, seeing as she wouldn't have had much exposure to accurate or positive information about it. Usually, you would portray her as knowing nothing about her brother's sexuality, and being a little shocked when she found out, and then coming to terms with it. It's rather historically inaccurate for her to be waving a pride flag this whole time, despite her background and circumstances.
If you didn't bring me Andy Warhol's autograph, you can just leave right now.
Oh, really? What is it with you and Andy Warhol, huh? What is it?
Do you have a boyfriend?
No.
I'm just asking.
It's odd, because Emmerich sometimes does give things set up for happening, like Danny enrolling in night school, which explains how he's able to finish his school year and go to university.
But sometimes he doesn't. Sometimes things just happen out of the blue, and we don't know why.
Sometimes some things happen, I don't know why anymore.
Danny is offensive as a character for a number of different reasons, but his greatest offence is being fucking bland. I didn't want to spend any time with this guy at all.
He may as well just be Kevin from Dante's Cove, but at least they only spent about 2 minutes on that guy's backstory.
I should have done this a long time ago. I'm gonna live with Toby in Dante's Cove.
I mean, when your character's generic as fuck, 2 minutes is all you really need. I guess at the very least they didn't give Danny his generic beefcake boyfriend, and he didn't end the film skipping into the sunset, so that's something.
Who is this movie even for, anyway?
The true tragedy of Stonewall is that it didn't have to be this bad.
With a different director and writer, Stonewall could be a credible or even good historical film, but instead it's an unholy, frustrating mess. There's a kernel of promise here, but it ends up being a reverse Pandora's box. Forget hope, the small fragment of something good just highlights how irredeemable the rest of the film is. So many of the things in Stonewall have either been done better by other movies, or would have been easily fixed with a few minor rewrites.
I have no idea who this film is for.
Homophobes won't like it because it's entirely about LGBT people. It's not a good introduction to LGBT history and culture because it's not accessible or friendly, and there's no characters that sheltered, tentative straight viewers can identify with. This is no Philadelphia, and for once I mean that as an insult.
LGBT people and their allies definitely won't like this. It's not even entertainingly bad. I'm genuinely stumped.
Nice. Oh, he's pretty, huh? Oh, you're a pretty one, huh?
No.
You wanna suck my dick?
I think he wants to suck your dick.
You wanna suck my dick?
Suck his dick?
I'm always working so hard putting the candies in the box.
After examining all the available evidence, I'm forced to conclude that Roland Emmerich made this film for one person, and one person only. Himself.
This is a movie made for someone who has dioramas of the Kennedy assassination in Perspect tables in his house. This is a film designed for someone who views history as negotiable, as something open to interpretation. This was made by, and for, someone who thinks that Shakespeare's plays were actually written by some weird incest fucktoy lord.
Well, Roland, I hope you enjoyed Stonewall, because you're the only person who possibly could. And now, a short list of other films you should watch instead!
Cruising. William Friedkin's film about a serial killer targeting the New York gay community is a far more intelligent and in-depth depiction of police brutality and harassment towards LGBT people than Stonewall, with a much more logical plot.
I didn't come on this job to shit-can some guy just because he's gay, Captain.
You're gonna come into days where you have to collar a dozen guys like that.
It's also a significantly more accurate depiction of a particular subset of the gay community in a very specific place at a very specific time. And while it was decried as homophobic, it depicts a huge range of LGBT characters. A favourite of mine is Da Vinci, a sex worker who offers the police vital information despite being frequently harassed and assaulted by cops.
They run me the other night, and this guy Simone, he made me give him hair right in his radio car.
Take your foot off the table. You're full of shit.
I swear to Christ!
How do you know they're cops?
Listen, man, you need me just as much as I need you.
Take a hike.
I can't emphasize enough how rad Da Vinci is and how I wish the movie had featured more Da Vinci.
Da Vinci for sexy president.
Cruising has a very distinctive visual aesthetic and mood, and despite the fact that it functions on one level like a purposefully shocking highlight reel of confronting gay sexuality, it still manages to be far less grotesque than Stonewall. Also, the movie doesn't look like somebody peed on it. Milk. Gus Van Sant's film about the successful election campaign and eventual assassination of openly gay San Francisco supervisor Harvey Milk is on some senses a very standard biopic, but after watching Stonewall, it looks fucking fantastic. The film is rooted in historical fact. Unlike many bland Hollywood biopics of queer people, it doesn't shy away from depicting Harvey Milk as a sexually active gay man, but it also doesn't have any of the bizarre grotesquerie present in Stonewall's horrified fascination with queer sexuality. It covers a different historical event, but you'll learn a lot more about the history of the Pride movement from Milk than you will from Stonewall. Also, this movie doesn't look like somebody peed on it. Pride. Pride is possibly the most genuinely prideful movie about gay pride, and I love it, and it also has actual history in it. It too has a generic protagonist, but his story is handled in a way that's significantly less cliched, and it fits with the tone of the movie.
Today we have to take advantage of that.
They called us perverts!
Bromley, it's time for an important part of your education. There is a long and honourable tradition in the gay community, and it has stood us in good stead for a very long time. When somebody calls you a name, am I right about this, Jonathan?
Dead right.
You take it, and you own it.
Prominent historical figures in this movie are actually allowed to be prominent, and the film's final footnotes feel like helpful bookends, rather than a slap in the face to real people who were barely featured in their own story. Also, this movie doesn't look like somebody peed on it. Pretty much any movie about male or trans sex workers. Midnight Cowboy, Breakfast on Pluto, My Own Private Idaho, Mysterious Skin, Tangerine, even freaking Twist. Yes, you heard me right, I'm recommending Twist, because even though it might be a bizarre adaptation of a Dickens story, where most of the actors mumble their way through bad dialogue,
And he made me sleep in a coffin, and that was in Kingston.
Even though it ends with the suggestion that the whole movie was some kind of horrifying time loop, it still has a far better understanding of the potential trauma surrounding sex work and childhood sexual abuse, and it's not in any way claiming to be some kind of important historical document featuring actual people who actually existed.
Your life is so great, Ray!
Getting beat up all the time and blowing guys in doorways?
Yeah! A life of excitement, baby!
Do you work so you can do this?
I do so I can work.
As a bonus, none of these movies look like somebody peed on them. Hooray! So that was Stonewall. It's not the worst queer movie I've ever seen, but that's only because I've watched Windows. It is, however, bad in ways I couldn't even begin to predict.
Funny fucking story, isn't it? Let's go.
I usually champion films made by queer directors, as they tend to touch on aspects of the queer experience that straight directors remain disconnected to, but I'll have to make an exception for this one. Not only does Roland Emmerich not seem to understand queer people, even though he is one, this whole movie seems completely disconnected from the rest of reality. It had random inconsequential sex slavery in it! So now, if you'll excuse me, I've got to... God, I can't even think of an appropriate sauna for this terrible depiction of history. I'm... fuck it, I'm out!
United Fruit. Every love across the land.